to be able to present KiteX here at the Wind Energy Conference, and more broadly, just airborne wind energy in general. Yeah, so I'm one of the founders of KiteX together with Gustav, which is actually also here. Let's just get started. So I think just one of the basic principles is that these parts of the wind turbine is what captures most of the wind, roughly 75%. And the main idea of airborne wind energy is, can we just take this piece of wing, put a string to it, the ground, and then get rid of the rest? And that is definitely possible, you could say. And I think this is probably the best showcase so far. This is Makani, and they're doing a what's called a flying generator, airborne wind energy turbine. And I think what's interesting about theirs is, so it's pretty big, 26 meters wingspan, has 8 generators on board. So once, or when the wing is flying through the air, these onboard turbines is actually generating the energy. So that's one way of doing it. And I mean, it's a pretty serious business they're growing. At least they put a lot of effort into making it work. Another way of going about it, like Kite Power, which is from the Netherlands, or come out of Delft, is to have a kite that you then pull on the tension, and then you have the generator on the ground, which looks like this in this case. And I think Kite Power is interesting in the sense that at least they promise or say they will deliver the first system next year. So let's see if they will be able to do so. And that's a 100 kilowatt system. Just stepping a little bit back and also maybe looking at the two technologies, one of the things I find really fascinating about kite energy is actually those two very different methods of capturing the energy. You have the exact same formula for how much power you, at least theoretically, the upper bound can extract from those systems. And the one part, at least the one part that is probably very familiar, is the wind speed squared. Then you need to add this cosine, which is kind of the angle of the, that's not kind of, it is the angle of the tether, basically. So that becomes quite important, and that's also why you won't see kites that are flying straight up, basically. They all need to pretty much get a pretty small angle, unfortunately. The next interesting aspect is the area, and that's definitely not the surface area of the disc, but more the area of the actual wings of the surface area. And then lastly, another important part, it's the lift-to-drag ratio, what's probably called, which is the lift of the main wing over the drag of the wing and the drag of the tether. And that enters into the second order, so that's also hugely important. And you need to do a bit of trickery to get this drag efficient for the line, but yeah, you can definitely do so. Talking about the cost, I think that's probably what most is interested in when you talk about wind turbines. If you look at the standard wind turbine, this is the breakdown of typical cost. And I think the main idea and the main hope is that you can reduce pretty much most what's related to the tower, the rotor blades, and then this is an old slide from 2008, but generator or gearbox, depending on if you have a generator or gearbox. But then it's going to be much, much smaller, at least if it's a flying generator. Much cheaper. And then, of course, the installation. But still, you only end up at half the price. So, I mean, this is not, you could say, revolutionary in the sense that it's going to blow wind turbines out of the water. And I think that's really the main problem, and that's also where kite energy is stuck at the moment. Because traditional wind turbines have definitely 30 years of head start, but also several gigawatts of head start. And it will definitely take multiple gigawatts of installation in order to compete with traditional wind turbine. But that said, then there is definitely areas where it will be interesting, and that's where I use the main advantage of these airborne wind turbines, which is that they are very easy to move around and also install. You don't need the cranes, particular, and you don't need to have the long trucks for transportation. So that's one area, and then the second other area is for the deep offshore places where, I mean, you're not really battling with both the first, the momentum, and then the second order trying to tip the whole thing over, so you can have a much more, smaller structure for offshore systems. Then I'll just briefly look a little bit of the trends within kite energy. So it is somewhat an established, I mean, maybe not established field to you, but to me it feels like it was somewhat established. There's been quite a bit of research, and also a lot of companies working on it. And most people, they started with the soft kites. Let's try. Yeah, left here. I think that's because it's easier, and in some cases you could even buy off-the-shelf soft kites for that was used for kite surfing. So for a university or a small company, it was a very easy way to get going. And also when you crash them, they break. Then there's hybrid solutions that have been investigated, and then also the rigid wings. And what I think is quite interesting, if you look right now, is almost all companies are transitioning this way towards the rigid wing kites. The only ones that are really left using soft or cloth is those that are trying to move ships around, and then actually this one kite power that I talked about earlier. But I think the main reasons is probably due to durability, and then possibly something about the lift to drag ratio. It's not really that fun. Then if you look at the two main options, ground generation, yeah, flight generation, then most of them, they end up in the ground generation part. And I think that's partly because that's where you start. If you do if you use a soft kite, then you don't have an option to put a generator on top of your kite, basically. So that means when you go along, then you start developing a system where you have ground generation. And then, I mean, there's also other advantages in terms of the aerodynamic efficiency of the kite, but I don't think that's why they chose it. Then we are to the right. And this is a little bit unfortunate, but it says launching and landing. And that, I think, is probably where airborne wind energy is at the moment. That's probably the biggest challenge. I think most companies have now been able to figure out how to get a kite in the air, fly it around, and generate some energy. But then come the next challenge is really to land and take off and get complete autonomous sea in the whole part of it. And that's also why we think that the one with the airborne, like flight generations where you have the turbines on the kite, is the best solution. And that's because you have much more control over the actual kite when you have so much power on it and you can deploy at all times. Alternatives within the solution is like Amplix Power. They're from coming out of Delft. They're making a big glider, and they're trying to land it like on an aircraft carrier and also launch it pretty much in the same way. So that's pretty optimistic, maybe, or at least take some time before they get to automate completely. Another option is to add small motors on traditional kites that can take them off like drones. Maybe six out of those companies I showed earlier are trying to do that. So lastly, this is our current state of the prototype. And I'll just step a bit back. This is about a year ago when we actually started. And the way we started was more in the sense that so Gustav and I had worked together in a previous startup, and then we needed to do something else. I really wanted to work with wind energy, and I actually applied to most of the Danish wind energy companies, but didn't get in. And then I wanted to get into airborne wind energy because I thought that was the future. So I wanted to get into Makani in the US, and I thought I couldn't really just go there, so I made this prototype of an autonomous looping kite. And then we realized that it's a lot of fun to go out in the field really and play and develop new systems. And also we felt that Denmark should really have an in on this new type of wind energy, so it would make sense to make a startup here working on that. And here's a few of the different prototypes we made along the way. So the first one, it's just a flying wing without turbines. Then we started making autonomous drones, simple drones indoors, one half corner, and so forth. And this is then the latest prototype. And what we're really trying to accomplish here is take off and then transition into what you call crosswind flight, which is the phase where you're actually going to get power out of it. So at the moment, we've modified like the control system to really keep tension in the lines all the time. And then now the transition, it's an autonomous transition, and now it's flying basically based on all the sensors, GPS, all that, a specific path in the sky. And in a moment, I'm going to flip it out of this mode. And then it will hover down and land. So I think this is what two guys was able to achieve in a little, about a year, but we also been doing other things. So I think it's definitely possible that we'll solve these autonomy problems and get these kites up and down. I don't think any kind can really be a doubt about that. So the next thing we're looking into is the design of the next generation system. We want to do something that's containerized. Much pretty much like this. We deliver 100 kilowatts, hopefully, rated power. This is how, when it's installed in Tanzania, not too long in the future. Alright, that's it.